Oh, good morning to you. It's a beautiful day, isn't it? It's glorious. So a very warm welcome in lots of ways. And we're praying that the weather holds out this week. At least we'll have a week of good weather, maybe. You never know. We're going to start with a psalm, Psalm 100. And it's a psalm of praise. It's a well-known psalm. And it goes like this. Shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come before him with joyful songs. Know that the Lord is God. It is he who made us, and we are his. We are his people, a sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving, and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and praise his name. For the Lord is good, and his love endures forever. His faithfulness continues through all generations. We can praise God for that. Let us just praise God. Thank you, Lord, for this psalm. Thank you for the psalmist who was really excited about how you deal with us and have helped us and continue to help us. This is their prayer for today as we look forward to looking into your word and the way that you dealt with your children of old and how you're dealing with us under this new covenant. Help us to be completely blessed with the service this morning, and that those that are listening on online later, that they also may be blessed. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
We're going to have our first hymn, which is By Faith We See the Hand of God.
The power of the gospel shall prevail.
Beautiful hymn, isn't it? And I chose that because it says that line, "We'll stand as children of the promise." And we're going to look at the promise that God gave to his children in Israel and the way that it is transformed to us as the new in the new covenant, as his new special people. So we're going to have our notices now. So we've got our open doors are 11 to 3. Did it go well last week, by the way?
It did.
Good, good. That's good. And prayer meeting 11:30 to 12:30. Everyone is very welcome, even if it's for a couple of minutes. And please, if you've got time at that time of day and you can't make it, please remember us at that time. On Wednesday, the trustees meeting at 12:30 as well. We have a little meeting in the little room where we have a few ideas. Pray that that God will give us a good time of clarity when we, as we look forward to the church growing here. And then, and Wednesday, the home group is at 7:30 to 9 o'clock at Brenda's. Is that okay?
Yes.
The questions at the back of the room. And yes, there's no Thursday up there, but there is a Thursday craft and chat group at 6 o'clock to. No, is it six? No, 7 till 9, isn't it? Yes. So please come along. First one, we had 11 people, which was really good. I can't remember what we're doing this time. Jan would be able to tell you, but she's not.
I think my Jan's doing something.
So, yes, I think she is. Okay, and then the 9th of June, it isn't me, actually. It's Gordon Hamilton next week. So a relief from me at last. So that's good. Do pray for Gordon as he comes along to preach to us. Also, there's some books out in the lobby that Janet and Davey would like people to take away, possible, and enjoy. So please help yourself to those. Okay, we're going to have a term of prayer now. Lots of things to pray for, obviously, when you know what's in your heart. Pray for my daughter, who's not very well at all at the moment. And that's why Jan's not here looking after the little one. And do pray for our Andrew, who, broke his foot and bashed himself up a bit with a fall in the night. And he's got a big boot on on the right foot. So he won't use crutches, so he'll be walking around on it. But pray for him. He'll be 4 to 6 weeks with that boot on. So the problem with Andrew, he's got a huge pain threshold, so he doesn't realise what pain he's in. But in a way, that's good, but in another way, he can't tell anyone so much. If you see a little scratch on his hand, then he worries about it. But if he can't see it, he doesn't worry about it. So do pray for him. So we'll come to a time of open prayer. I think really we're good to pray for the situation in the Middle East and the peace talks. Let's just pray that it will happen this time. Let's pray.
Take care of Kirsty at this difficult time.
Yes.
Strength to come through this difficult time that she's going through in your heavenly name. Amen.
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 Yes, Lord, I pray for Kirsty, Lord. She's been in A&E now for 4 days, Lord. It's a terrible time with what she's going through in her life at the moment, Lord. So we just offer a prayer, Lord. I just pray, Lord, that you're the only one who can heal her at the moment, Lord. Mm-hmm. Pray, Lord, that you will come close to her and let her feel your loving arms around her. And I also pray for Andy as well, Lord. And bring them both to you in the name of Jesus. Amen.
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 Dear God, we thank you for the visit of Janet's son and daughter-in-law over the last couple of weeks.
Amen.
Dear Lord, we do thank you for so many blessings that you give us. You give us peace in a troubled world. And that are in Christ Jesus, we have a peace of mind as well. We can rest on the loving words of Jesus. We thank you that he is always there to watch over us, to guide us and direct us. And Lord, we thank you that we can come to him, who is a source of life. In him we have life, and life, we have life more abundantly. And we thank you for these words of promise that you have given us. We need that word in our heart and in our minds so that we do not get led astray.
Yeah.
So that we can have a peace of mind, knowing that whatever happens, God is still on the throne.
Yeah.
He is still able to do all things that we ask in prayer. So we come to him this morning, we thank you for that love shed abroad in our hearts, and the love that he has shed abroad then, that others may see Jesus. And we long that the veil may be lifted from the eyes of people and their minds. We do think of Kirsty this morning and any who have mental problems at this present time. Pray for thou, Lord, that you'll give her peace. We also pray for those who have physical problems, who are unwell through our constant growing old. And there's so many things that happen to us, Lord, when our body starts to decay, as it were. So we do thank you for loving us, most of all, and showing that love at Calvary.
Yes.
And the blood that was shed washes us whiter than snow. We cleanse, and we thank you for that. We do not have to worry about the sins that have been in the past. But of course we are conscious, Lord. Maybe that's a good thing. It reminds us that sin is in the world, and it is a problem. It's a big problem. But Lord, you have come to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness, and we thank you. So we pray for this place of worship. We long, Lord, that others may come in. Pray that you will build your church wherever it may be. Around the world, places of difficulty, where the church is persecuted relentlessly.
Yeah.
And yet the people stand firm. Many of them lose their lives because of that. Many churches are being burnt to the ground and pastors are being killed. Such is the hatred Christianity, such as the hatred of God. They don't love him. They have no desire to seek his face.
No.
Seek his face where it may be found. Lord, we do thank you. We just keep thanking you for every day that you give us. The mercies that we receive from your hand, and the food and the clothes and the homes that we live in. We're reminded that there are many homeless, helpless, and abandoned people around the world. We need to know the love of Jesus.
Yeah.
And we thank you for those missionary societies that are doing all they can in difficult lands. We thank you, Lord, that there are such societies that reach out for the lost.
Yeah.
And Jesus came to seek and save the lost. We thank you, Lord, that he done that with us. So thank you, Lord. Amen.
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 Dear Lord, can you please be with the the peace talks that are going on.
Yes.
And please don't abandon us. Please be with them. And also the peace for Ukraine. Just conflict after conflict going on in the world, oh Lord. And I pray for all the elections that are going on, that people will not be angry. And I pray for peace in people's hearts, oh Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Lord, we bring to you little Grace Barnes, who's also injured her foot and is wearing a boot. And it's hard for a little one. They want to be able to bounce around and play with their friends and brothers and sisters. And Lord, we just committed to you. We pray you'd, you'd give good healing to her limbs. And it won't be too long before she's joining the fun again. And we look forward to seeing her at the Missy Church next week and pray that she'll be feeling much more like herself then. We thank you for all that family and all those who come to Missy, and we commit each one to you. Amen.
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 Dear Lord, we thank you for this time of worship before your throne. We do pray for those that are struggling at the moment, think of Kirsty and Val, and all those that are not able to come here for various reasons, that you will bless them. And I pray that you'll be with Richard and his carers. I know that he listens to this later, so do think of him. And all those that are not able to come today, we do remember them as well. So Lord, be with me as we look at your scriptures a bit later, and as we come to the communion in a minute, I pray that our hearts and minds be maybe attuned to what you would have us think about your sacrifice. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Going to have our second hymn. It's a very old one, Tell Me the Old, Old Story. But that's what the children of Israel were told to do, to keep telling the story of what happened. And after that, we are going to have our communion time before the Lord. So it's a good reminder of why we're here and what we're doing, and the reason we carry on. So tell me the old, old story.
Unseen things above, of Jesus and his glory, of Jesus and his love. Tell me the story simply, as to a little child, for I am weak and weary, and helpless and defiled. Story softly, with earnest tones and grave. Remember, I'm the sinner whom Jesus came to save. Tell me the story always, if you would really be in any time of trouble a comforter. This one's empty glory is called costing me too dear. Yes, and when that world's glory shall dawn upon my soul, tell me the old, old story, Christ Jesus makes thee whole. Tell me the old, old story, tell me the old, old story, tell me the old, old story of Jesus and his love, of Jesus.
We've got another old hymn later after this communion service, and looking at the words, I thought it would be really good to meditate on these words. It's the old rugged cross, and as you go through the verses, I won't go through the refrain each time, but on a hill far away stood an old rugged cross, and that reminded me that the pictures we have of crosses, they are beautiful, they're polished. That wasn't how Jesus had it. I brought it today. I made one for the talk that we did to the youth group. It was really, really rough, tied together with string. And that's how Jesus would have been crucified. It wouldn't have been a pleasant thing, because it would have, the splinters would have gone into him. It was not. But of course, it was an emblem of suffering and shame, because he was naked. And I love that old cross where the dearest and best for a world of lost sinners was saved. Oh, that the old rocket toss, so despised by the world, has a wondrous attraction for me. Does it? Does it really have an attraction for us? It should do. It should be the focus of all that we think about. For the dear Lamb of God left his glory above to bear it to the dark Calvary. Remember, Jesus is one of the three of the Trinity. He had that glory before. He equal with God, yet he came and did all this for us. That's incredible, isn't it? In that old rugged cross, stained with blood so divine, a wondrous beauty I see. For 'twas on that old cross Jesus suffered and died to pardon and sanctify me. It was an unpleasant sight. Crucifixion was awful. But to see the Lord of glory, the ones whose hands did no wrong, that had healed many people, that had taken little children to him and has taken us to him, yet here he was, bloodied and despise and spat on. But he gives us this because he wants us to see glory. To the old rugged cross I ever be true, to shame it, shame and reproach gladly bear. Then when he calls some day to my home far away, there where in glory we'll share what it meant. So I cherish the old rugged cross, till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross, and exchange it someday for a crown. Beautiful, isn't it? Those words are beautiful, and I couldn't say it better. So let's come to this communion service, this remembrance of what God has done to us through the Lord Jesus Christ, and come with praise, wonder, and also sadness of what he had to go through to redeem us. For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Sorry, Magic, can you give thanks?
Heavenly Father, we've just been singing about telling the old story. If you first back thousands of years to this story we're thinking of now, where Lord Jesus, on that night, being betrayed and being ill-treated and crucified. And we want to think of this emblem of the bread, because it, as we just heard, it stands for body of our Lord Jesus that was physically mistreated and ultimately he was killed on the cross, and is to remind us that it was a real thing. It was a physical thing that happened.
Yeah.
We go on to look at why, but that was also a physical thing that happened. And now we look behind and we see the cross we have on the wall is empty, because we know that it was part of a purpose that you suffered and died. It was Jesus that suffered and died, and we come and thank you now for the love that he had for mankind, and we thank you that we can take this bread and remember those things. Amen.
Amen. So as we eat this bread, we do remember our abused, broken body of our Saviour, and give him thanks for all that he has done for us.
Amen.
In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes."
Amen. Heavenly Father, thank you for shedding the blood of Calvary, the blood that was to save us. We will drink now, and we'll drink once again in the left and the ever after. In your heavenly name.
Amen.
Amen. So as scriptures say, we drink this in remembrance of what he has done for us. But also, as our brother said, we will be remembering it in heaven. But we'll be remembering with our eyes rather than with our mouths. So thank you, Lord Jesus, for what you have done.
Amen. Amen.
By singing the old rugged cross.
Yes.
Bless you.
There's a wasp there, Andy.
Oh,
wasp.
Hello.
Oh, it's huge.
Yeah,
it's
got an empty glass.
We've gone over there, Lord.
Hey, it likes me. Okay. Oh, that's huge. Interesting. Cool, out you go. He really wants to go out. Go. Oh, you get frizzle there. So where's the light from? Who is he? Oh, there he is. It's huge. Yeah. Wow. Interruption play. It's not going to go out, is it? Oh, goodness. Oh, help. It's on the floor down there. Wow, that was big, wasn't it? Where were we? Yes. The old rugged cross, that's where we were. It's exhausted. And she's...
On a hill far away stood an old rugged cross, the emblem of suffering and shame. And I love that old cross where the dearest and best for the world of lost sinners was slain. So I cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will clean cling to the old rugged cross
Exodus of old.
Yes, that's true.
The Lord said to Moses, consecrate to me every firstborn male. The first offspring of every womb among the Israelites belongs to me, whether man or animal. Then Moses said to the people, commemorate this day, the day you came out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery, because the Lord brought you out of it with a mighty hand. Eat nothing containing yeast. Today, in the month of Abib, you are leaving. When the Lord brings you into the land of the Canaanites, Hittites, Amorites, Hivites, and Jebusites, the land he swore to your forefathers to give you, a land flowing with milk and honey, you are to observe this ceremony in this month. For 7 days, eat bread made without yeast, and on the seventh day, hold a festival to the Lord. Eat unleavened bread during those 7 days. Nothing with yeast in it is to be seen among you, nor shall any yeast be seen anywhere within your borders. On that day, tell your son, I do this because of what the Lord did for me when I came out of Egypt. This observance will be for you like a sign on your hand and a reminder on your forehead that the law of the Lord is to be on your lips. For the Lord brought you out of Egypt with his mighty hand. You must keep this ordinance at the appointed time, year after year. After the Lord brings you into the land of the Canaanites and gives it to you, as he promised on oath to you and your forefathers, you are to give over to the Lord the first offspring of every womb. All the firstborn males of your livestock belong to the Lord. Redeem with a lamb every firstborn donkey, but if you do not redeem it, break its neck. Redeem every firstborn among your sons. In days to come, when your son asks you, what does this mean? Say to him, with a mighty hand, the Lord brought us out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. When Pharaoh stubbornly refused to let us go, the Lord killed every firstborn in Egypt, both man and animal. This is why I sacrifice to the Lord the first male offspring of every womb and redeem each of my firstborn sons. And it will be like a sign on your hand and a symbol on your forehead that the Lord brought us out of Egypt with his mighty hand.
Thank you. Before we come to look at this passage, we're going to have another song, Tell Out My Soul. to us today, does it? But in fact, it has. It has a great relevance. And I've entitled this talk this morning, Living as God's Redeemed Children. It shows us or illustrates us the two ways or commands from God on how we should live our lives as redeemed children. Firstly, we are to set aside our old life. Remember, they've been delivered, these children of Israel, from slavery from Egypt. The Israelites only got out of Egypt by God's hand. The same as us at our conversion, only by God's hand. I watched a film not long ago about Moses. It was terrible, to be quite honest. But one point that did come over, because it was inaccurate, and Jana said, well, you're going to have to, because I got to start tutting at the TV, because it's inaccurate. He said, well, you'll just have to look at it as a drama. But one of the things they did say was, when Moses came, he tried to free the Israelites with his own hand, and it failed. And God said to him, now I'll show you how it's done. Well, that didn't happen. But in fact, if you look at that, that's how it would have happened if it had been done by man's hand. They were not able to get out of Egypt on their own. It was God's great mighty hand, as we have just read, that got him out. And it's the same with us. If we look at our first passage that we're going to look at today, next other passage, it's in Ephesians 2, verses 1 to 10. And Paul waxes lyrical about how this new life is in Christ. It says, as for you, you were dead in your trespasses and sins. You were dead, completely unable to save yourself, in which you used to live when you followed the ways of this world and the rulers of the kingdom of the air, the spirit who is now at work in those who are disobedient. That's the devil. All of us also lived among them at one time, gratifying the cravings of our flesh, doing our own thing and following its desires and thoughts. You see the theme here that's coming out. Like the rest, we were by nature deserving of wrath. That's the only thing we deserve. But because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ even when we were dead in trespasses. That's incredible, isn't it? When we were in the gutter, when we were completely and utterly not looking for him. It is by grace you have been saved, God's riches at Christ's expense, and God raised us up with Christ and seated us with him. He wasn't just content with saving us, he was raising us up to be his sons and daughters. Wow. And God raised us up with Christ and seated with him. It's worth saying, in the heavenly realms, in Christ Jesus. In order that in the ages coming, we might show the incomparable riches of his grace expressed in his kindness to us in Christ Jesus. He's saying, this is all done for you through the love of God. For it is by grace you have been saved through faith. This is not from yourself. It is a gift of God. Even the faith that we have is a gift of God, not by works. If it was by works, then our natural inclination is, and I've heard it saying, well, I've done enough to deserve salvation. But it's not true. It says, so that you can, nobody can boast. For we are God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. So going back to this Exodus thing, you see that this is a parallel with how we are as a new in the new covenant. We're talking about a new covenant. This is the covenant that God had given. He'd given a covenant to Abraham, and now he was fulfilling that covenant as it went through, as they came out of Egypt. And this was this new ownership of God. So in verse 1 it says this. It brings this word consecrate. The Lord said to Moses, consecrate to me every firstborn male. The first offspring of every womb among the Israelites belong to me, whether human or animal. Consecrate, the Hebrew word is kadesh, which is set aside, kadesh. So in the new life, they had to set aside many of their old habits and ways of doing things. In fact, all of their old habits, and this was a new life completely. And this is expressed very well by this in verse 3, really. It says this, when Moses said to the people, commemorate the day of you came out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery, because the Lord brought you out with a mighty hand. Eat nothing containing yeast. Now, I don't know if you remember In the 70s, I'm old enough to remember this, 70s and early 80s, they had this thing called friendship loaf. Do you remember it? Used to send people a little bit of dough, and you'd say, you take a bit off and then send it on to someone else. And that was an idea of getting everyone to bake this cake, friendship cake. I was a bit dubious about it because I could see the fingerprints on. No, I couldn't. But you know what I mean. You took a bit off and then you passed it on to someone else and it went on and on. It was called a friendship cake. And this is what this is about, isn't it? Because that's the way that the Israelites used to bake their cakes. They would take a little bit out, put it aside and use the bit. And then they would go on and on and on like that. And you say, no, not anymore. There's no leaven. There's no yeast in here. This is a completely new way of looking at things. No yeast. Yeast, the old batch, was moved on, as it was with this friendship cake. Little bit passed on. God says, no, you have a new life in me. It's a complete way, new life of doing it. So no longer will you have this batch that you're looking back. No longer, if you're referring it to us, we're no longer in the law. The law doesn't have effect with us because we're in Christ. It doesn't mean we disobey the law because Jesus said, I came to fulfill the law. And in me, the law is fulfilled. But we are not structured by saying, if we do this, this, and this, and this, we become a Christian. It is all by the grace of God. It is all by his love. It is not done by works. And this is what God was saying to the Israelites. This is a new way of doing things. And you commemorate this to remember the way that I took you out of Egypt and placed you in this new land. Also, verse 4 is significant. It says, today in the month of Abib, you are leaving. Now, you say, well, why is that significant? Because it's spring. It's the spring. It's new life. We think of spring as lambs jumping up and down and even strange people jumping up and down. But, you know, it's it's all about new life. It's all about the flowers coming out of the ground. And this is the new life in Jesus Christ. Jesus said in John 10, verses 10, he said, I have come that I may have life and that you may have it more abundantly. This is a new life. The seed in the ground, as in the sower, and in the parable of the sower, is sown by the preacher or wherever it is, by God, and it comes out into new life. And this is what it's talking. It's a new life. It's a new way of looking. You're saying to the Israelites, this is a new way that I'm sending you through. And I'm also bringing you forward to a new promised land in verse 5. He reminded them of his promise that they will come into a different and more importantly, better place. When the Lord brings you out into the land of the Canaanites, the Hittites, the Amorites, the Hivites, and the Jebusites, the land he swore to your ancestors to give you, a land flowing with milk and honey, you are to observe this ceremony in this month. It's all about observation of these things. It was the promises given to Abraham in Genesis 12, verses 6 to 7. You look it up. The promise of a promised land. And the promise in 15:18 that his seed will be massive and that the whole of his seed, one of his seed, will bless the whole of creation. And that is, of course, the Lord Jesus Christ. The promise was there, the promised land. New beginnings, promised land. All this must have been very exciting for the Israelites. Oh, how quickly they forgot. But in verses 6 and 7, it says, for 7 days eat bread made with yeast, without yeast, and on the seventh day hold a festival to the Lord. Eat unleavened bread during those 7 days. Nothing with yeast in it should be seen among you, nor shall any yeast be seen anywhere within your borders. No longer a slave, but an heir. And they're saying, look, this is a celebration of what you are. You're no longer a slave to the Egyptians. And as we go over to the other side, we're no longer a slave to sin. We're heirs of Christ. Isn't that fantastic? He's taken away our sin. We've been talking about that at the communion service. About the old rugged cross. And the forgiveness in the Lord Jesus Christ. He's taken that away and he's given this sonship with him. Isn't that incredible? Seems a bit unfair in a way for God. But for us it's a glorious inheritance. And this is what the Israelites were told would happen. And they were to celebrate this because it was a new beginning, because it was a new way of looking forward. It was to go forward, not to look back. A bit like Lot and his wife, do you remember? He was taken out of Sodom and Gomorrah. There's so many good parables in the Old Testament. There they were taken out through the pleading of Abraham. They were taken out and they were removed. And the angel said, don't look back. Don't look back to Sodom and Gomorrah. Go forward to this new beginning that I'm giving you. And of course, Lot's wife looked back and was turned to salt. Don't look back to your old life and hanker after it. Because this is a new life, a life more abundant, as it said in John 10, verse 10. Exciting, isn't it? Jesus said, no one sews an old patch of unshrunk cloth on an old garment, for the patch will pull away from the garment, making the tear worse. Neither do people pour out new wine into old wineskins. If they do, the skins will burst, the wine will run out, and the wineskins will be ruined. No, they pour new wine into new wineskins, and both are preserved. It's a clean break, he's saying. Now we are redeemed people. We enter into the living waters of John 4, having been adopted into the family of God. Isn't it incredible? He's taken our sins away, and he's given us so much more, so much more. We're no longer a slave, but an heir. And this is emphasized by Paul in Galatians. In Galatians 4, verses 4 to 7, he says this. Oh, it's superb, this bit. But when the set time had fully come, God sent his son, born of a woman, born under the law, to redeem those under the law. You see how this works? That we might receive adoption of sonship. Because you are his sons, God sent the spirit of his sons into our hearts, the spirit who calls out, Abba, Daddy, Father. So you're no longer a slave, but God's child. And since you are his child, God has made you also his heir. We have this inheritance with God. Isn't it incredible? We leave behind that sinful nature. We're not slaves to sin, but we're not free from sin. That's obvious. We're our own living. But now, it doesn't become natural to us. I was talking with Andy in one of our discussions and one of our meetings, and I was saying about, yes, we do sin, but when we sin, we feel guilty. This conscience is awakened in our hearts and our minds. Everything is no longer, oh, we can take the blame away. Some people like to blame anything but themselves. The blame game. And sin is like that. It will do that. Look at the beginning of sin when it came into this world at the Garden of Eden. What did Eve say when God said, why have you taken this fruit? Said, but the serpent gave it to me. He's blaming the serpent. The serpent convinced me. The serpent that you made convinced me. And then he said to Adam, why did you take it? And he said, because the wife told me to. It was a blame game, wasn't it? And that's how we do with sin. And no longer will we do that if we are true Christians. We have a conscience pricked that says, no, we're wrong. And we come back to that never, ever, ever failing mercy seat of God, and he forgives us. That's incredible, isn't it? And that's the new relationship that these Israelites were coming into. They very soon departed from the right way and suffered under it. And just a little side here, that if we do sin, there is always consequences for our sins. There is always consequences for our sins. And therefore, we need to be always conscious that we can't just sin, that grace may abound. Remember that scripture in the New Testament? I can't remember where exactly it says. I think it's in Romans. It says, but therefore, maybe you should sin more so grace abound. And Paul said, God forbid. Because that's not how it works. We have a conscience. And they had a conscience there that was there to tell them. They had to look back from their deliverance of Israel, from their deliverance from Egypt, and to thank God for all he has done for them and is doing for them and will do for them. So this should be our reset, to please God, not ourselves. And that's what we should have. It's a reset because we fail often. So we press that reset button and say, no, Lord, we did wrong. We come back, we ask for forgiveness, and here we go again. And God will continually forgive us. That's amazing, isn't it? It is amazing. You know, it's the same as the gift of the Holy Spirit in a way. The gift of the Holy Spirit is there for us. Sometimes we grieve the Holy Spirit. It's pushed to the back of our life. Then we come back to God and ask us to fill us with the Holy Spirit. And he does it time and time and time again. Incredible. It's not just a one chance salvation, is it? It's there. It is because it is in Christ and he forgives us and forgives us and forgives us. And we go on. We will be forgiven. Even the Israelites who did some horrific things were forgiven. If they turned back to him, they were forgiven. Do you remember the story of Jonah? Jonah was told to go to his enemies, to Nineveh, and preach repentance. He refused to go. He ran away from God, which was really foolish. God set him right. And in the belly of the fish, he said, salvation is of the Lord. I realize now I'm wrong. He was spewed out on the beach. He went and told, and he preached repentance. I'm not sure how he preached it, probably lukewarm. But they repented. And what did he do? He sulked. I knew you were a merciful God. I knew you'd forgive them. They're our enemies. What are you doing? It's a bit like us sometimes. We need to know about forgiveness. We need to be about repentance. And we need to know the love of God and the mercy of God that he will forgive. So that is a new beginning for them, a new way of living. But then they have to set aside their new life, don't they? Going back to the first verse, it says they were consecrated, which is, as I say, kaddish, set apart. So let's look at verses 11 to 13 and see how they were set apart. After the Lord brings you into the land of the Canaanites and gives it to you, as he promised, an oath to you and your ancestors, you are to give over to the Lord the first offspring of every womb. All the firstborn males of the livestock belong to the Lord. Redeem with a lamb every firstborn donkey. But if you do not redeem it, break its neck. Redeem every firstborn among your sons. Needs an explanation about the donkey, the poor old donkey. Why is it being singled out here? Well, it was a sign of unclean things. The donkey, as you look in the lists that are unclean animals, donkey was one of them. But it was ceremoniously unclean. But it was very important. If you go through the stories in the Bible, the donkey features a lot. Balaam even talks. But, you know, the donkeys were important to them, so they needed to be able to redeem them. And in Numbers 18, verses 14, it talks about redemption and about the sacrifice for those, the Lamb of God, as it were, the Lamb being sacrificed in their place. It explains how you can keep your donkey. And you can see the parallel with the sacrifice of Jesus, of course, the ultimate sacrificial Lamb. In Luke 2, verses 21 to 23, it says that Jesus' parents consecrated Jesus to the Lord. Now, that's a bit strange, really, in a way. He didn't really need to be consecrated because he was pure, wasn't he? But he did, because he had to be pure in all his ways, and he had to to fulfill all the law. And he needed to fulfill the law to be the perfect sacrifice. And so they brought this child to be blessed. And of course they had this incredible validation from Simeon and from the prophetess Anna. Yeah, I have seen the glory of the Lord. What the parents must have thought, having seen all this. Lord, it is so important that they saw all this and this precious gift that was given to them. How they brought that child up and how they saw him grow. showed his perfect sacrifice. In verses 11-13, we see the consequences of this. We need to know that our redemption is forever. It is this life and the next, not just the Lord's Supper. So it says in verses 11, after the Lord brings you into the land of the Canaanites and give it to you as he promised an oath to you, you are to give over to the Lord the firstborn of every womb. All the firstborn males of your livestock belong to the Lord. Redeem with a lamb every firstborn donkey, but if you do not redeem it, break its neck. Redeem every firstborn among you, your sons. I know I've read that twice, but it's important to know that it's important for him that the whole law was completed in Christ. It wouldn't have been any good if Christ had sinned, then his sacrifice would not have been accepted to God. But he rose again, showing that he had that death had no power over him because he was perfect, and we can be perfect in him. So with this new life, how do we live? How do we live? Well, in Philippians 4, it gives us an idea of how this is possible to live, or how we should be looking to live with this new life that we have in Jesus. What's our new attitude? We put back all the things that we've had before, all the attitudes and all the ways that we've lived, and now we're going to live a different way. We're going to live according to what God wants us to live. And in Philippians 4, verses 4 to 8, it gives us a list which is quite amazing, really. Rejoice in the Lord always, so that's good. We praise God. Maybe we can say we've done that. I will say it again, rejoice. Let your gentleness be evident to all. Be gentle with each other. The Lord is near. Do not be anxious about everything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your request to God. Do you see the theme there? It's all about pleasing God. It's all about involving God in your life, not just going ploughing ahead with things. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds in Christ. Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. Wow. That's quite an exhortation, isn't it, to do that? And we're exhorted to do that because that's what Jesus did. He was a gentle Saviour. He was someone that looked for other people rather than his own thing. But finally, we have a duty, don't we? So this is a new way of living, a new life, set-aside life, someone that's set aside for God, and we're looking to please God. We're looking to involve God in our whole lives, not just on Sunday. Every decision we're saying, oh Lord, is this right? You know, that's important, isn't it? But also, we have been told we have a duty. If we read in this passage, in 8 to 10, it says this, 8 and 10, on that day, tell your son, I do this because of the Lord did this for me when I came out of Egypt. This observance will be for you like a sign on your head and a reminder of your forehead. You can see that now. They have these little things on their head. Give them the law of the Lord be on your lips. For the Lord brought you out of Egypt with his mighty hand. You must keep this in ordinance at the appointed time after every year. It's to remember what God had done for him. And then in verses 14 to 16, in the days to come, when your son asks you, what does this mean? Say to him, with a mighty hand, the Lord brought us out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. When Pharaoh stubbornly refused to let us go, the Lord killed the firstborn of both people and animals in Egypt. This is why I sacrifice to the Lord the first male offspring of every womb and redeem each of my firstborn sons. And it will be like a sign for you and on your hand and the symbol on your forehead that the Lord brought us out of Egypt with his mighty hand. We have a duty to tell others about why Jesus is so important to us. Why Jesus and God is the focus of our lives. There's lovely Proverbs, isn't there? In Proverbs 22, verse 6, it says this. Start children off in the way they should go, and even when they're old, they will turn from it. Beautiful. Give them illustration from the beginning. It's our responsibility to our children. In fact, all Christian adults have a duty to teach juniors, those below us, about the Lord Jesus Christ. In Ephesians 6, Paul was trying to help the church to live a better life. We'll try and help them to be more Christ-like. And in Ephesians 6, he says this, Fathers, children, do not exasperate your children. Instead, bring them up in the training and instruction of the Lord. So let us be on the front foot and take primary responsibility of teaching children about Jesus. And I mean, I grew up in a church that had very good youth groups. And I think the tendency sometimes for Christian parents is to let the youth group leader do that. But the Bible says, no, you should be given an example to those children. Responsibility to teaching children about Jesus. And if we're church people, that is a great responsibility to tell others about why the Lord Jesus means so much to us, why he is so important to us, why we love him so much, why we do these things. Give a reason for the faith that is within us. It is our responsibility to tell everyone about Jesus and why he means what he does to us. So just to recap, and then I'll finish, I promise. We have been saved from our own sin by the perfect sacrificial Lamb of God, as with this Exodus. It was taken out of Egypt by the power of God. And we've been adopted into Jesus' family. And if we ask him for repentance, he will forgive us. And he will give us a full life, a life more abundant. When we don't have to fear about things. When we can bring all these things to him, that's the life more abundant, isn't it? We're not on our own. We have the great fellowship of all people that believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. And we have, above all else, the fellowship and the power of the Holy Spirit within our own lives. Isn't that incredible? It should encourage us, shouldn't it? We're reminded in Romans 8, verse 32, he did not spare his own son, but gave him up for all. How will he not also, along with him, graciously give us all things? We have all that we need. We may not have all that we want, but we have all that we need, and we need to trust him. And as I said last week, or a few weeks ago, in 1 Corinthians 16, you are not your own. You were bought with a price. Remember that. It's nothing of your own doing. God is there. And I'm glad of that. Because if it was something of my own doing, maybe I would think it's flawed. But salvation is perfect. All your life belongs to him. And it's out of gratitude we should serve him. And not only that, because God is who he is, he will give us a better life, a more abundant. So the question to ask ourselves, including myself, of course, is that are we holding out on God? Maybe in time, in effort. In fact, anything that gets in the way of God working in us. We need to just examine our own hearts, just to think about maybe things that we've blocked God working in us. So we need to set aside our old life, like the people that came out of Egypt. Set aside it. Don't take up that old dough. It's a new life. And set apart our new life. Even that which is precious to us, we need to be able to give it to the Lord. And let us love the Lord our God with all our heart, our mind, and our soul. And out of that, we will love our neighbour as ourselves. Let us pray. Dear God, thank you for this passage. I thank you that the Israelites were given this great chance. Lord, sadly they rebuffed your desire to have them as a precious thing. But Lord, also before we judge them, we do that often. And we go our own way. Help us to leave behind our old life, not to keep looking over our shoulder, and to glory in what you have given us in this new life. Help us to be constantly seeking to serve you, seeking to be more like you. And Lord, your word has said that if we do this, you will indeed sanctify us, set us apart to be yours. Thank you for all you have done for us, are doing for us, and will do for us. In Jesus' name, amen. I'm going to finish with him. You're the Lion of Judah.
You're the Lion of Judah, the Lamb that was slain. You ascended to heaven and evermore will reign. At the end of the age, when the earth you reclaim, you will gather the nations before you. And the eyes of all men will be fixed on the Lamb who was crucified. For with wisdom and mercy and justice you'll reign at your father. And the angels will cry, hey, who was slain for the world, the ruling power. And the earth will reply, as the King of all kings and the Lord of all. There's a shield in our hand and a sword in our side. There's a fire in our spirits that cannot be denied. As the Father has told us, for these you have died, for the nations that gather before you. And the ears of all men need to hear of the Lamb who was crucified, who descended to hell, yet was raised up to reign at his Father's side. And the angels will cry, Hail, Lord, who was slain for the world, There's a shield in our hand and a sword at our side. There's a fire in our spirits that cannot be denied. As the Father has told us, for these you have died, for the nations that gather before you. And the ears of all men need to hear of the Lamb who was crucified, who descended to hell, yet was raised up to reign at his Father's side. And the angels will cry, Hail the Lamb, who was slain for the world, ruling power. And the earth will reply,
do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us. To him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus, throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen.
Amen.